Lecture this afternoon. We're very happy to have Margaret Barker here. She's in the United States for the John A. Widso Foundation conference that was held last Thursday and Friday in Los Angeles on sacred space and sacred threads, where Margaret was the keynote speaker. We thank the Widso Foundation for covering the cost of Margaret being here. We also thank our sponsors, BYU Studies. And if you didn't get the coupon for BYU Studies materials on the table as you came in, you may want to pick that up as you go out. We're also grateful to the Academy for Temple Studies, which you can visit on templestudies.org, where a copy of Margaret's talk today will eventually find itself there. Also, we're grateful to the London Temple Studies Group, which Margaret started 10 years ago in London. They just had a conference a couple weeks ago in London celebrating their 10th anniversary. And we thank all of you who are here. Before I introduce Margaret, I'd like to invite Dan Bachman to come up. He's our bibliographer for the Temple Studies Academy to offer the opening prayer.
Our kind Heavenly Father, on this very special occasion, we are appreciative and grateful for our blessings, and especially for the privilege to have Mrs. Barker here among us. We're grateful for the safe travels she had from her homeland to California and from there to here. And we are grateful for her willingness and her unselfishness to give of herself and of her learning. We appreciate and are grateful for the insights and the understanding that she has brought to many of us regarding the ancient temple of Solomon and the tabernacle, the time of the tabernacle. We pray, Father, that thou will bless her as she delivers her address here this hour. We're grateful for those who have organized and prepared this. We're grateful for those who have funded and financed it, and we express our appreciation for all of these things in the sacred and holy name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Well, now I'm thrilled to welcome Margaret Barker back to Provo. This is not her first time, and we hope not her last. She's known to many of you. As a scholar, she received her degree in theology from Cambridge University and went on in 1998 to be elected to be the president of the Society for Old Testament Studies there in England, where she, among other things, edited the Society's second monograph series published in London by Ashgate. I think you would all agree with me that she is one of the most insightful and innovative biblical scholars of our time. Her facility with Hebraic etymologies and overlooked alternative textual readings has yielded for all of us surprising spiritual insights. Let me also say that she reaches out to be involved with environmental kinds of groups. One convened by His All Holiness Bartholomew I, the Ecumenical Patriarch, where Margaret has been able to extend these theoretical and theological principles into developing a new area of environmental theology. In 2008, she was awarded a Doctor of Divinity by the Archbishop of Canterbury in recognition, he said, of her work, which has made significant new contributions to our understanding and opened up important fields of research. As a genuine friend and human being, Margaret Barker is a mother and grandmother. She is a Methodist preacher and has been involved for more than 30 years with the work of a women's refuge in her community. She is incredibly generous and encouraging to all of us. I won't give the list of 17 books that she has published so far, but among my favorites and relevant to her topic today are books like The Gate of Heaven, The History and Symbolism of the Temple in Jerusalem, Temple Theology, Temple Themes in Christian Worship, The Mother of the Lord, The Lady of the Temple, 2012, and her latest book, The King of the Jews, in 2014. Margaret intuitively senses the importance of temples. I think more than any other contemporary scholar, she recognizes that the temple was the dominant institution in every ancient society that we can think of. Her work draws attention to such themes as temple visions and angels, the veil and throne, covenant and tree of life, wisdom and unity, transformation and transfiguration. Her topic today is The Lord is One, Imparting Holiness, Deification, and the Ritual of Theosis, or in other words, the human becoming divine. Please pay close attention. Margaret, we welcome you. Thank you for being here. We'll turn the time over to you.
Well, it is lovely to be here. I have to begin with a little apology. You had to watch all the furniture being moved. This is because I can't cope with spotlights, so everything had to be moved around. But all is now well. What I'm going to talk about this afternoon is developed from some thoughts I had about John's Gospel, chapter 17. This is our Lord's Prayer after the Last Supper, before he goes to his death. And I begin with a line from John chapter 17. Jesus said, "I in them, and thou in me, that they may become perfectly one." Thus Jesus prayed after the Last Supper. John set these words as the culmination of Jesus' teaching, and they are about participation in the divine. The chapter is often called the High Priestly Prayer, and the book of Hebrews shows that Jesus was proclaimed as a great high priest. There are several elements in the prayer that suggest a temple setting. For example, Jesus' words, "Father, glorify thou me in thy own presence with the glory which I had with thee before the world was made." The divine presence of which Jesus was speaking was located in the Holy of Holies. This was the innermost part of the tabernacle, or of the temple which was modeled on the tabernacle. In the temple, the Holy of Holies was a golden cube which housed the chariot throne of the Lord and its flanking cherubim. But in the smaller tabernacle, the throne was represented by the mercy seat with its cherubim. This is where Isaiah saw the Lord and heard his voice. This is where the Lord spoke to Moses and appeared to Aaron. The Holy of Holies was hidden behind the great curtain, the veil of the temple, which separated the holy place from the most holy. The veil, woven from four colours that represented the four elements, represented the matter of creation. In other words, the divine presence was hidden beyond matter. And in Hebrew, hidden is written in the same way as eternal. The distinction between the holy place and the most holy place, or Holy of Holies, they both translate the same Hebrew words. The distinction between the holy place and the most holy place is central to understanding the biblical view of participation in the divine. Holy meant that a person, place, or object had received holiness, but could not pass it on. Whereas most holy meant that a person, place, or object was actively holy and could impart holiness. The most holy place, therefore, imparted holiness to any person or object that had been beyond the veil. The rituals of the Holy of Holies affirmed or imparted holiness, and the Most Holy One imparted holiness to others who became holy ones, or in the more familiar Christian term, saints. The temple priests were angel messengers of the Lord of Hosts, entrusted with knowledge from the Holy of Holies. They remained part of the undivided holiness of the divine presence, whether they were within the holy place or without. Objects as well as people could be most holy and so impart holiness. The showbread, literally the bread of the presence, was most holy. The prescriptions for making and eating this bread are no longer quite clear, but it was set out before the Lord each Sabbath. When the fresh bread was set in place, the bread that had been before the Lord for 7 days was eaten in the temple precincts by the high priests. It was most holy. In other words, the bread imparted holiness to the high priests. Malachi, complaining that the angel priests of his time had betrayed their sacred role, said they had given false teaching and offered impure bread. He prophesied a time when the pure offering would be restored, and the Christians claimed that this was fulfilled in the bread of the Eucharist, which had the same role as the ancient showbread. Those who ate the most holy bread participated in the divine state. The perfumed temple oil also imparted most holiness. This was the sacrament, and I'm using an anachronism here, this was the sacrament of theosis, becoming divine, and so an anointed one, a Messiah, imparted holiness. And now a passage from Exodus chapter 30. These are the Lord's words to Moses. You shall make of these spices a sacred anointing oil blended by a perfumer. A holy anointing oil it shall be. And you shall anoint with it the tent of meeting and the ark of the testimony, and the table and all its utensils, and the lampstand and its utensils, and the altar of incense and the altar of burnt offering with its utensils, and the laver and its base. You shall consecrate them that they may be most holy. Whoever touches them will become holy. And you shall anoint Aaron and his sons and consecrate them that they may serve me as priests. The holy anointing oil was used only in the temple. Any imitation for personal use was forbidden, and the meaning of the oil was found only within the teachings of the temple. Any secular use would make no sense. This was because the oil imparted knowledge. The temple understanding of holiness included illumination of the mind. Isaiah said that when the king was anointed, he received the Spirit of the Lord, that is, the Spirit that transformed him into the Lord. He received the Spirit of wisdom, of understanding, of counsel, of might, of knowledge, and of the reverence due to the Lord, the fear of the Lord. His perfume, and this word is usually translated delight, and it's not delight, his perfume would be the reverence due to the Lord. In other words, the anointed one retained the perfume of the oil, and this identified him as the Lord. Paul said, many centuries later, that Christians were spreading the perfume of the knowledge of the anointed one, which did not mean knowing about Jesus. It meant having the knowledge that Jesus had because he was the anointed one. That's 2 Corinthians. Since the whole temple represented the creation, the divine presence beyond the veil represented the state beyond time and matter from which the visible world was formed. In temple discourse, this was day one. The golden Holy of Holies represented the pre-created light of the glory, in which there was no time, no division, and no change. It was the state before the material world was created and separated out into distinct kinds, as described in Genesis 1. The Hebrew storytellers did not speculate about the one and the many. Instead, they told the story of day one, using a cardinal number without any implied sequence. And then they spoke of the second, third, fourth, fifth, and sixth days, ordinal numbers which implied sequence and thus time. The key words in Genesis 1 are separated and according to their kind. During the early years of Christianity, there was a debate among the Jewish rabbis about the meaning of day one. There were many suggestions. One was that it meant the day when the Holy One was one with his creation, or perhaps one in his creation. The debate was linked to the origin of the angels, who were also divine beings, and so participated in the divine state. The rabbis could not agree that the angels originated in day one. On the second day, they said, or on the fifth day, but the rabbis agreed that there were no angels in day one. The issue was plurality within the divine, participation in the divine, and the response was emphatic that the angels did not originate in day one. Christianity emphasized the law of the Holy of Holies and the angels. They called it the kingdom because it was the place of the divine throne, and they were the new holy ones, the saints. This prompted a great sensitivity among Jewish teachers about the term sons of God in the Hebrew scriptures and about the angels in day one and their being part of the divine. The matter was complicated by the fact that the Hebrew word for God usually has a plural form, Elohim, and so can mean also gods or divine beings. Psalm 82 begins, Elohim has taken his place in the council of El. In the midst of Elohim, he gives judgment. And then at the end, you are all Elohim and sons of the Most High. Now here, the first Elohim has a singular verb, but this Elohim singular is in the midst of Elohim who must somehow be plural. Further, the plural Elohim were sons of the Most High God, Elyon. So the psalmist must have known about other divine beings in the heavenly council, and so we assume around the heavenly throne that was in the Holy of Holies. The older belief, then, was that there were angels in day one. In Genesis 1, there are only echoes of the older belief. God, Elohim, is the creator, but the verbs in the chapter are sometimes singular and sometimes plural in form. So God said, singular, let there be light. But God also said, let us make a human being, Adam, in or as our image. The story continues, God created the Adam in or as his own image, in or as an image of God. He created him, male and female, he created them. So here, in these few lines, we see the problem that faces any investigation into what the Hebrew scriptures record about participation in the divine. Was this word God, Elohim, a plural of majesty used to indicate a singular reality, Or was there a memory of plurality within the divine, such that a male and a female were necessary to be the image? And who was El Elyon, God Most High, the father of these divine Elohim? Now remember, Gabriel told Mary that her son would be called a son of the Most High. So presumably, the first Christians thought of Jesus as one of these Elohim. And how could Adam be the image of the Elohim or function as the image of Elohim? In temple discourse, Adam, the image of Elohim, was the original high priest. Just as the temple building represented the creation, so the high priest represented the creator. He was the image of Elohim in his temple. The human who was anointed as high priest became the presence or image of the creator on earth. And anointing, as we should see, was important for glimpsing how the temple ritualized participation in the divine. The high priest wore the sacred name Yahweh on his forehead, and in the anointing ritual, he was marked on his forehead with a diagonal cross, the ancient symbol for the name of Yahweh. Participation in the divine also implied incarnation, and so a human high priest was regarded as a son of God in human form. The Jews accused Jesus of blasphemy when he claimed to be a son of God, but Jesus reminded them of the sons of God in Psalm 82, and the one who was consecrated, literally made a holy one, and sent out into the world, namely the high priest. This is John chapter 10. In the time of Jesus, Adam was known as a son of God. This is the end of the genealogy in Luke chapter 3. And Paul showed that all Christians were sons of God. All Christians were also anointed. The name means anointed ones. And so they were heirs to the high priestly role. As St. Peter wrote, a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation. The issue of plurality within the divine, participation in the divine, and incarnation of the divine all underlie early Christian discourse. And this is why the matter of the angels in day one was sensitive among Jewish teachers at the end of the Second Temple period and into the early years of Christianity. The rabbi's position was clear. The angels did not originate in day one. Other pre-Christian Jewish texts, however, said there were angels in day one. The Book of Jubilees, a Hebrew text used at Qumran, says that the spirits which serve before him were created at the very beginning. So too, Psalm 104, which describes the creation whilst praising the Creator. It follows the Genesis pattern from the second day onwards, dry land and water, then plants, the lights of heaven, sea creatures and Leviathan. But the psalmist knew that the angels and spirits existed before the earth and the sea were set in place. This implies that they existed in day one. The psalmist wrote, the Lord is clothed in light, his chariot throne was the clouds, his angels or messengers were the spirits or winds, it's the same word in Hebrew. All these existed before the earth was set on its foundation. In temple discourse, this means the angels were in the Holy of Holies, around the chariot throne of the cherubim, and this is where Isaiah and Daniel saw them. The Lord asked Job if he had witnessed the creation when the angels sang as the foundations of the earth were set in place. The angels and powers in day one, which are listed in texts outside the Hebrew Bible, are not mentioned in Genesis 1:1-5 as a part of day one. even though their existence is implied in several canonical texts, Psalm 104, as we've just seen, Job 38, and the prophet's visions. In other words, the ancient canonical accounts of the creation included the angels, but the account in Genesis did not. This is because there was a cultural revolution in the 7th century BC, and the scribes who later shaped the transmission and formation of the Hebrew Bible tried to suppress all knowledge of heavenly matters such as angels, becoming divine, and union with the divine. Teachings about the Holy of Holies, the Bible calls them matters within the veil, that's Numbers 18, were entrusted only to the high priests, and the revolutionaries said that what mattered was keeping the law of Moses. So Deuteronomy 29, the secret things belong to the Lord our God, but the things that are revealed belong to us and to our children forever, that we may do all the words of this law. And so ancient law about becoming divine and the incarnation of the divine now lies beneath the surface text of the Hebrew scriptures and in the writings that were not accepted into the Hebrew Bible. The manifesto of the revolutionaries was the book Deuteronomy, and their influence was both widespread and long-lasting. They removed key concepts from the older texts. One of them was the hosts, the heavenly powers, and another was the belief that the Lord could be seen in human form. An ancient title for the Lord was Lord of Hosts, but after the Deuteronomists' editing, the hosts disappeared. The Deuteronomists also denied the ancient belief that the Lord was seen in human form, what the Christians would later call incarnation. Isaiah saw the Lord enthroned as the King, the Lord of Hosts, and John said this had been a vision of the one who was incarnate as Jesus. Ezekiel saw the likeness of a human form enthroned in radiant glory. Daniel saw a man clothed in linen and girded with a golden sash, which was the dress of a high priest. And when Hippolytus, the Christian writer, produced his commentary on Daniel about 200 AD, he said that the man in linen that Daniel saw was the Lord, not yet indeed as perfect man, but with the appearance and form of a man. The Deuteronomists, however, said that no divine form was seen, and so even when Moses received the Ten Commandments, they said, this is Deuteronomy chapter 4, the Lord spoke to you out of the midst of the fire. You heard the sound of words, but you saw no form. There was only a voice. The older account of Moses on Sinai was very different. This is Exodus 24. They saw the God of Israel, and there was under his feet, as it were, a pavement of sapphire stone, like the very heaven for clearness. The people who transmitted the text that became the Hebrew scriptures tried to suppress the older belief that the Lord had appeared in human form, despite the testimony of Isaiah and Ezekiel. And yet Christian commentators such as St. John and Hippolytus knew the significance of the visions in a human form. Jesus's high priestly prayer in John 17 had this temple setting. He and his disciples knew of the glory of the Holy of Holies and what it represented. They knew the conflicting beliefs about angels in the Holy of Holies, and they knew that the Lord had appeared in human form as the King. And so John begins his gospel, the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. We have beheld his glory. Jesus's prayer assumed the older beliefs. He and his Father were one. He and his disciples would be one. and those whom the disciples brought into the community would also become one. Jesus had almost completed his time as the human presence of the Lord. He said, "I have glorified thee on earth. I have manifested thy name to the men whom thou gavest me out of the world." And he was preparing to return to the state whence he had come, day one. I and the Father are one thing. The divine unity was not broken whilst the Lord was incarnate. He would return to the Holy of Holies, as did the high priest with the self-sacrifice of the Day of Atonement. The one who emptied himself while in the form of a servant refers to the high priestly ritual of self-emptying on the Day of Atonement, when the servant of the Lord poured out the blood that represented his own life, in other words, the life of the Lord, to cleanse and consecrate the temple which represented the creation. Hebrews explain that the death of Christ was the final act of atonement, in which there was no substitution of a goat to represent the Lord, who was the high priest. The book of Hebrews begins, "When he had made purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high, having become as much superior to angels as the name he has obtained is more excellent than theirs. The anointed one who emptied himself in atonement did not lose anything of his divinity at his incarnation. This was the high priest who was the Lord of hosts." Jesus prayed that his disciples would see him in the glory of day one, to which he was returning after his atonement self-sacrifice. Again, John chapter 17, "Father, I desire that they also, whom thou hast given me, may be with me where I am, to behold my glory, which thou hast given me in thy love for me before the foundation of the world." Jesus had shared the glory of day one. He had come forth from day one. At the beginning of John's gospel, he was in the beginning with God. The Father had consecrated him and sent him into the world. In other words, he had come forth as the high priest anointed in the Holy of Holies. As he prepared to die, Jesus prayed that his disciples would also see him restored to glory in the Holy of Holies. This is the hymn in Philippians 2 that celebrated the enthronement, when heaven and earth recognized the exalted Jesus as the Lord, the Anointed One. It was this vision that John recorded at the end of the book of Revelation. The title of the book itself shows that St. John was preserving and interpreting Jesus's own visions. Now, the title of the book is "The Revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave to him to show his servants what must soon take place." It's the visions of Jesus. In St. John's stylized arrangement of the material, the great revelation opens with Jesus's vision of the servant, or the lamb, it's the same word, enthroned, receiving the sealed book, which symbolized the heavenly knowledge, and being worshipped by all creation. It culminates in the vision set in the Holy of Holies with the golden throne and the tree of life. This is Revelation 22. Both the throne and the tree had been removed from the temple in the Cultural Revolution more than 600 years previously. But people had not forgotten the older ways. In fact, they cherished them and looked for the Messiah to restore them. Jesus prayed that his disciples would see him in that restored glory. And then John's words from Revelation 22, "The throne of God and the Lamb shall be in the Holy of Holies," or day one. "His servant shall worship him. They shall see his face. His name shall be on their foreheads. Night shall be no more. They shall need no light of lamp or sun, for the Lord God will be their light, and they shall reign forever and ever." The disciples, his servants, would wear his name on their foreheads. In other words, they would all be, or would collectively be, the high priest. When the high priest was anointed, he was marked on his forehead with the sign of the name, which was the diagonal cross. And here in John's vision, all the servants bear the cross, and they see the glory of the face or the presence. It's the same word. They see the glory of the face or the presence of the Lord. Bearing the name in the divine presence meant that the servants had become divine. Even while they still lived on earth, they were part of the divine. It was not exclusively a post-mortem state. St. John described how the transforming glory came to earth. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us, full of grace and truth. We have beheld his glory, the glory as of the only Son from the Father. This Holy of Holies state of unity underlines such familiar lines as Galatians chapter 3, "You are all one in Christ Jesus." Paul's emphasis was setting out the practical implications of participation in the divine state of the Holy of Holies, that after baptism, when the Christian was washed, anointed, and marked with a name as a high priest, there was neither Jew nor Greek, slave nor free, male nor female, because they were all one in Christ Jesus. God and the Lamb, here in Revelation 22, here, the throne of God and the Lamb, this is something that I write hyphenated altogether, was one of the ways that Hebrew storytellers and visionaries indicated the human participation in the divine. The human and the divine were listed always in that order, so God and the Lamb. The human and the divine were listed in that order, but followed by singular verbs and adjectives. Thus, in the chronicler's account of Solomon's coronation, but not in the Deuteronomists, the reformers, the people bowed their heads and worshipped the Lord and the King, run together with hyphens, so to speak. Not in the Hebrew, but it's the Lord and the King are one. This is what the Hebrew actually says. The Lord and the human King are one. It is stated, but not explained. Modern translations, such as the Revised Standard Version, alter the Hebrew text to read, "They bowed their heads and worshipped the Lord and did obeisance to the King," implying two distinct actions, one for the Lord and another for the King. By changing the text, such translations, if you can call them such, remove one of the most important pieces of evidence in the Hebrew scriptures for how the King became divine. To him who sits upon the throne and to the Lamb, Revelation 5, is one being, is another divine and human singular, as the Greek text chosen for the old King James Version shows. Hide us from the face of him who is seated on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb, for the great day of his wrath has come, and who can stand before it? The phrase, "the Lord and Christ," the phrase "Lord and Christ" is similar. He was both the divine Lord and the transformed human anointed one. The ancient kings were known as the Lord and his anointed, all run together. When the seventh angel blew his trumpet, the voices in heaven proclaimed, "The kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of our Lord and his Christ," all run together. And Peter preached, "God has made him both Lord and Christ," run together, "this Jesus whom you crucified." The heavenly Lord, the earthly Messiah, were one. The beloved unitary Son brought the glory to earth, and those who saw the incarnate glory were transformed into sons of God, angels, in the way that those who had entered the glory of the Holy of Holies had become holy ones. Jesus's words about this have not survived well the translation from Hebrew into Greek, and the original nuance has been lost. In John 17, we have, "For their sake, I consecrate myself, that they also may be consecrated in truth." What it actually means is, "For their sake, I will show myself as holy, or perhaps I will show my holiness." I consecrate myself here represents what we call the niphal form of the Hebrew word kadash, to be holy, and means to show oneself to be holy. The Lord said to Moses, "I will show myself holy among those who are near me, and before all the people I will be glorified." When Jesus showed his holiness to his disciples, they were consecrated, they became holy ones, they caught the holiness, and they became divine. Jesus sent out his disciples as holy ones on earth, just as he had been sent out from heaven. Their role was to join all things together. There is an early explanation of this unity of the angels written by Theodotus. He was the disciple of Valentinus, a brilliant Christian teacher in mid-second century Rome, who almost became bishop there. So it is unlikely that his contemporaries labeled him a Gnostic and a heretic. That's how some people think of him now. This is what he wrote. "Now they say that our angels were put forth in unity and are one, that in that they came out of the one. Since we existed in separation, Jesus was baptized that the undivided should be divided until he should unite us with them in the fullness, so that the many, having become one, might all be mingled in the one which had been divided for our sakes." Quite complicated, you need to think about that. But clearly he's saying that the many were drawn back into the one by the coming of Jesus. This was no Gnostic innovation, nor is the idea of the Son uniting all into the divine unity a sign of Gnostic influence. It was temple teaching from the Holy of Holies, day one, when the Creator was one with his creation. The Enoch tradition preserves some of this, and in the first book of Enoch, there is a summary of one of Enoch's visions of wisdom. Enoch was taken up among the angels, and there he learnt the hidden things, the matters within the veil that were known only to the high priests. And since this was the place of the throne, he was learning the secret things of the kingdom, how the kingdom, day one, was divided, how the actions of men were weighed in a balance. He saw all parts of the creation moving in their appointed ways, keeping faith with each other in accordance with the oath, the covenant which they observe. This was the eternal covenant, covenant as it was understood before the Deuteronomists changed the emphasis and applied it only to people keeping the law of Moses, rather than to the whole creation functioning within the bonds of the great covenant. This is why they wrote, and we've had this before, "The secret things belong to the Lord our God, but the things that are revealed belong to us and to our children forever, that we may do all the words of this law." Jesus restored the wisdom of the Holy of Holies, which Paul taught the Christians at Corinth. He said to them, "We impart a secret and hidden wisdom of God, which God decreed before the ages for our glorification," 1 Corinthians 2. Secret, hidden, and before the ages all indicate teachings of the Holy of Holies, matters beyond the veil. And now, a few lines from the letter to the Ephesians, first chapter. "He has made known to us in all wisdom and insight the mystery of his will, according to his purpose which he set forth in Christ, as a plan for the fullness of time, to unite all things in him, things in heaven and things on earth." Like Enoch, Isaiah saw the whole creation. He was taken up to see the throne, and he heard the seraphim calling out that the whole world was full of the glory of the Lord. His reaction was to recognize that he was not teaching the truth, that he was a man of unclean lips. And the revelation in this vision was that the threefold holiness, the holy, 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 the threefold holiness of the King, the Lord of Glory, the revelation in this vision was the threefold holiness of the King, the Lord of Hosts, whose glory filled the world. This vision can be dated fairly securely to 742 BC. And so this is the earliest known example of the temple mysticism of the Holy of Holies and participating in the divine. Isaiah saw the glory and the Lord of Hosts. He heard the triple holiness, presumably meaning the degree of holiness that imparted most holiness, double holiness, and was there purified as a messenger or angel. Isaiah's vision offers a glimpse of the royal cult at that time, the king enthroned amidst his angel priests and sat upon the throne as Lord and King. Isaiah recorded other aspects of the temple cult. The king was the child of his heavenly mother. She was the hidden or eternal lady. This is the word that's often translated virgin in Isaiah 7. And the king was born among the angels and given the fourfold angel names, it's Isaiah 9:6. And he was anointed with the spirit that made him the Lord and endowed him with manifold heavenly witness. With the government upon his shoulder, that's a reference to the special robes that were worn, particularly the ephod on his shoulder. With the government upon his shoulder, he became the human presence of the Lord, and Isaiah recorded this role too. A later disciple reused these poems, and they're now found in a later part of the book of Isaiah, but they originated in the time when there was still a divine king in Jerusalem. The servant king, this is Isaiah 42, where the poem is reused. The servant king was the covenant. In other words, he himself was the focus and the means of unity. The servant king was the one in whom the Lord glorified himself, just as Jesus had glorified him. In other words, he'd been his glory on earth. And in the same way, Jesus would be glorified in his disciples. The servant king, according to Isaiah, was raised up, given understanding, anointed. He saw the light of glory, and the knowledge he acquired enabled him to put right or to restore many people or things. The clearest description of his role as the means and focus of unity is hidden under the familiar words of Isaiah 53, verse 5, which are an example of temple wordplay and double meanings. The line which we usually read, upon him was the chastisement that made us whole, and with his stripes we are healed, can also be read, our covenant bond of peace was upon him, his responsibility, our covenant bond of peace was upon him, and by his joining us together, we are healed. This is the central line of the poem, because this was the main role of the servant king, and this is the prophecy expounded by Jesus on the road to Emmaus, when he explained his suffering and resurrection to his disciples. The original has to be reconstructed from texts that were not transmitted by the spiritual heirs of the temple revolutionaries, who managed to obscure much of the ancient temple wisdom. We now turn to the most important evidence for this ritual of theosis, the human becoming divine. And it is a text which has suffered from the scribes who sought to obscure the older ways. These spiritual heirs of the revolutionaries who opposed the sacral kingship of the first temple, and this was restored in Christianity. The Hebrew scriptures were finally formed and defined after the destruction of Jerusalem in 70 AD, and so after the advent of Christianity. And there are places where this seems to have influenced which texts were included in the Hebrew scriptures. Significantly different pre-Christian versions of some Hebrew texts were found among the Dead Sea Scrolls, and many of the differences suggest that the Jews adopted a form of the Hebrew text that excluded material important for Christian claims. The two most quoted texts in the New Testament, Isaiah 52:53, which we've just looked at, and Psalm 110, are examples of this. The text of Isaiah is now perfectly readable, but there was a different version used at Qumran, and the text of Psalm 110, which has not been found at Qumran, is now so damaged in places it is impossible to read at all. Both texts deal with the Messiah. Isaiah 52:53, as we've seen, is about the anointed and exalted servant who sees the glory, receives heavenly knowledge. Psalm 110 is about the anointing and heavenly birth in the Holy of Holies. These two texts, there are many more, are an illustration of why it is necessary to read beneath the current Hebrew text in order to recover temple tradition about participation in the divine. Psalm 110 describes the anointing and heavenly birth of the King as the divine Son, that is, as the incarnation of the Lord. This is the temple precedent for St. John's claim, the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. The most damaged verses in this psalm are verses 3 and 7. But the setting is clear. It's the Melchizedek ritual. And since Jesus was proclaimed as Melchizedek in Hebrews chapter 7, the process of his anointing and heavenly birth was important for the Christians. The two damaged verses once gave vital information. Reconstructed, Psalm 110 verse 3 is about the heavenly birth of the King. By reading the words with different vowels, and this is the usual English translation, on the day you lead your host upon the holy mountains, you read those with different vowels and one changed consonant, it becomes on the day of your birth in the glories of holiness or in the glorious garments of a holy one. Like dew your youth will come to you becomes with dew, that's the name for the holy anointing oil, with dew, I have begotten you. The Greek translation here was, I have begotten you, showing that this was indeed a royal birth text. The King was not born from the womb of the morning, as so many English translations say, but he was born from a gracious lady as the morning star. Morning star, as we know, was a Davidic title used by Jesus in the book of Revelation. I'm the root and offspring of David, the bright morning star. This heavenly birth in the Holy of Holies was no longer familiar to the Jewish teachers in the time of Jesus. John opens his gospel by showing how this fundamental of old temple teaching had been forgotten. Nicodemus simply did not understand when Jesus spoke about being born above, from above, or born again, anothen. Greek word can be either. And about seeing the kingdom. John described Nicodemus as the teacher of Israel, and yet he did not recognize what Jesus was saying. The traditions preserved outside the texts that eventually formed the Hebrew scriptures did recall this heavenly birth in detail. Enoch, recording what must have been the inner experience of anointed one, said this, and I'm reading now from a collection known as the Second Book of Enoch and chapter 22. I saw the Lord. I fell and did obeisance to the Lord. And Michael, the Lord's greatest archangel, lifted me up and brought me into the face of the Lord. And the Lord said to Michael, take Enoch, take him from his earthly clothing, anoint him with the delightful oil, and put him into the clothes of my glory. And Michael took me from my clothes. He anointed me with a delightful oil. And the appearance of that oil is greater than the greatest light. Its ointment is like sweet dew, its fragrance like myrrh, it's shining like the sun. And I gazed at myself, and I had become like one of the glorious ones. The early Christians shared this experience, and they sang about it. The Odes of Solomon, a collection of Syriac hymns, most of them in Syriac anyway, identified in 1909, but at first they revealed no obvious context because their content was so strange. It is now clear that the setting was early Christian initiation, and the odes show how they understood baptism and anointing. The Christians were temple mystics, and they continued to use the theosis ritual of the temple. So, bits from the Odes of Solomon. The Lord renewed me with his garment and possessed me by his light. My eyes were enlightened, my face received the dew, and my breath or my soul was refreshed by the pleasant fragrance of the Lord. Or, the Spirit brought me forth before the Lord's face, and although I was a man, I was named the Light, Son of God. And because I was most glorified among the glorious ones and the greatest among the great ones, according to the greatness of the Most High, so she made me. She is the Spirit. And according to his newness, he renewed me. He anointed me with his perfection, and I became as one of those who are near him. The roots of these hymns and of so much in the New Testament and other early Christian texts is the world of the Holy of Holies, where human beings could enter and be transformed by the most holiness that surrounded them. In the old temple, this was the privilege only of the high priesthood, which included the king. The experience empowered them with wisdom and bound them into the covenant of loving kindness. They became part of the Lord, and on earth they continued to be the presence of the Lord, using their wisdom to uphold the covenant of loving kindness. Jesus extended the ancient priesthood to all his followers, empowering them to share his role as the Lord on earth. And then John's prologue again, to those who recognized in him the transforming glory of the beloved Son, he gave power to become the children of God. Thank you.
Thank you, Margaret, very, very much. Lots to think and ponder about there. What we're going to do now is I'd like to invite our three respondents, and they happen to be sitting Larson, Peterson, Skinner, alphabetically. So I thought this was a sign that we should go in that order. But I'd like to also invite Jenny and others to, if you have a question that you'd like to ask, Jim over here and Jenny on this side, we have some 3x5 cards, and if you'd like to ask a question, go ahead and fill that out. We may not have time to answer all of them, but if you'd like an answer, thinking that we might not be able to get to it, put your email address on it, and we'll do our best to get you an answer. So David, we've asked each of them to respond for 10 minutes, helping us to understand and appreciate some of the things that Margaret has said. All three of them have lots of experience writing and talking and researching about this very topic, and I'm very eager to hear how they internalize and relate to the things that have been said. David, would you like to go first?
Thank you, Jack. I really appreciate the opportunity to be here and to give a brief response to what Margaret's shared with us. She shared something that is so deep and rich that I really don't feel that I have much to add to it. I would like to talk about some of the themes that she went into, and perhaps how we may apply some of those to our LDS scripture to better understand some of the things that we were reading there. Before I get into that, I wanted to take the opportunity to mention, and I don't know that I've done this before, but just to mention the influence that Margaret has had on my own research. After I finished my bachelor's degree in Near Eastern Studies here at BYU, I didn't know that I could continue on in this field of biblical studies and find a place in that world for myself. But as I started to, or as I continued to read, I came across Margaret's work, and it inspired me so much, and the possibilities that I found and the inspiration that I saw in the things that she was uncovering, that was one of the main inspirations for me to go back and continue with my graduate studies. And a lot of what I have decided to pursue in as my own interests have really been inspired by Dr. Barker. And so I appreciate all that she has done and that she continues to do. Margaret touched on the idea of the ascent to heaven and the fact that we can find this ascent, this journey to the heavenly holy of holies in the writings of Isaiah and other prophetic texts in the Bible. And I think there's so much that we can get out of that as we look at these texts, that we can imagine these prophets ascending into heaven and standing before the Lord and what would have gone on in these situations. And I think Margaret has really helped explore that world and what we can get out of it. I wanted to touch on a little bit more on some of those ascent texts that we can find. Margaret also mentioned the fact that a lot of these types of texts, the journey to the throne of God, didn't make their way into the biblical writings because of this prejudice against the older temple cult. However, if we look at some of the apocryphal texts or pseudepigraphal texts that circulated in that second temple period, we see a lot of these themes come up. Margaret mentioned Enoch ascending to heaven and standing there in the divine council. There's some interesting aspects to that type of tradition that play into this idea of becoming one with the Lord. James Vanderkam described a tradition found in several ancient Jewish texts that expresses the notion that humans somehow have a heavenly double or a counterpart in heaven. And when they ascend to heaven, they find themselves somehow, or they're shown in vision themselves sitting upon the throne of God. Andrei Orlov has explored this idea and found the same type of thing in the Enoch text known as 2nd Enoch. In 2nd Enoch 33, the patriarch Enoch is installed in heaven as the heavenly scribe. Then God commands Enoch to write some certain things, the things that he's learned in heaven, and then sends him back down to earth to share the content of these writings. But when he commands Enoch to go down and share these writings, God declares that they are things that he himself has written, although he had commanded Enoch to write them. So we start to see this conflation of the role of God and the role of Enoch. God is taking on Enoch's role. Enoch is taking on God's role. And it's a very interesting idea Enoch is promised a throne in heaven. He's given a position very similar to God. And we see this theme going throughout these texts. There are traditions in these texts about Jacob. A scholar named Jarl Fossum has discussed the idea that Jacob is taken up to heaven and he sees his image engraved on the throne of God. Then the angels show him further that Jacob, his image is not only engraved on the throne, but he is somehow identical with the form of God on the throne. And these texts are very confusing, and it's hard to tell exactly what's going on. One that's a little more clear is a text about Moses called Exegage, written by Ezekiel the tragedian. And in this text, Moses is taken up into heaven, and he sees this noble man sitting on the throne. And Moses comments, "He beckoned me, and I stood before the throne. He handed me the scepter and told me to sit on the great throne and gave me the royal crown, and he departed from the throne." The exact identity of this noble man on the throne is not given. We may assume that it's God himself. But in any regard, Moses is given this place on this divine throne and given a scepter and a crown. So again, we see this conflation of the one who ascends to heaven with the figure on the throne. And their identities are shared in some way. Margaret mentioned the conflation of God and the Lamb, that there's the divine throne with God and the Lamb sitting on it. I thought it was interesting if we compare that to Joseph Smith's vision of heaven, where he saw the heavenly throne, and he says it was the Father and the Son seated on the throne. They both seem to be seated on the same throne. And so this idea that we can find in these ancient texts is perpetuated there in Joseph Smith's visions. Also in the LDS Pearl of Great Price in the Book of Mormon, Enoch claims to have been promised a throne in heaven. So whether it's the same throne as God is seated on or if it's his own separate throne, the individual is promised a position similar, if still subordinate, to God's. Another interesting ancient text known as the Testament of Abraham has some very interesting ideas. Abraham ascends to heaven, and he sees a man seated on a glorious golden throne. Most would assume that this figure would be God himself. The person ascends to heaven, sees a throne, it must be God seated on the throne. Abraham notes that the appearance of this man is like that of the Lord. Abraham sees this figure weeping and sorrowing, and he asks his angelic guide, "Well, who is this weeping on this throne?" And he is told that it's actually Adam, that Adam is there and he is weeping because he's seeing so many of his children on earth making wrong choices and following the wrong path. But we see that for Abraham, this figure looks like the Lord. To him, it's an identical figure with the Lord. Just on that note of weeping in heaven, this also shows up in the Pearl of Great Price, where Enoch witnesses God himself weeping because of the sins and suffering of the human race. So a very similar situation. When Enoch is allowed to see through God's eyes and witness this suffering for himself, he is then also moved to weep just as God did. This is a significant aspect of the oneness that exists in the heavenly Holy of Holies. The individual is often able to see what God sees, know what God knows, and even feel what God feels. As an interesting side note, I was speaking with my father about these traditions and this idea of this empathy of seeing through God's eyes. My father works a lot with near-death studies, and he commented to me that in many accounts of near-death experiences, there is this feeling of unity or oneness with the light that they behold, or with God himself, or with other individuals. Individuals have described being able to see through God's eyes, or to share briefly in God's knowledge, or experience the empathy or love that God has for others, or being able to see through the eyes of another individual and feel what they are going through. So I thought that was an interesting parallel there. But back to the Testament of Abraham. Sorry, I'm getting so excited here. going back to the Testament of Abraham, Abraham then sees another figure on a throne, and this figure is judging, and the figure looks just like the previous figure that he'd seen enthroned, and he says that this figure was bright as the sun and looked like the Son of God. He is told by his angelic guide that this is actually Abel, the son of Adam. And so we see these parallels where Adam looks like God, Abel looks like Adam and like God or the Son of God. And this oneness is created where there's this great similarity to all these figures who have ascended up to heaven. So I'll skip over some of the other things I was going to say here. But there's also here a very interesting parallel in the Book of Mormon to what Margaret was saying about John 17 and the high priestly prayer or the intercessory prayer, where Jesus is with the people in the Book of Mormon, and he prays to them, and his prayer is actually very similar to the prayer he gives in John 17, where he asks that the disciples that are with him and the people that are with him can become one in the way that he is one with the Father. And what is very interesting, and I think parallels a lot of what Margaret was saying with this temple context of all of this, is that when Jesus hears the people pray, he then prays to the Father, and then it says, "And it came to pass that Jesus blessed them as they did pray unto him, and his countenance did smile upon them, and the light of his countenance did shine upon them." Now, these are the words of the high priestly blessing from number 6, "The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord lift his countenance upon you." That's exactly what's happening here. "The light of his countenance did shine upon them, and behold, they were as white as the countenance and also the garments of Jesus. And behold, the whiteness thereof did exceed all whiteness. Yea, even there could be nothing upon earth so white as the whiteness thereof." So we see in this prayer, Jesus asks for them to be one. They are actually transfigured, and they look like Jesus. In a very real sense, they're becoming one with him. And this is in 3 Nephi chapter 19. So I appreciate very much Margaret's insights into here, and I think what she is uncovering with all of this, the temple context, the high priestly context, has a lot to do with what we find in our LDS scriptures, in the Pearl of Great Price, in the Book of Mormon, and we would benefit greatly from applying some of these concepts that she is sharing with us to our study of our own scriptures. Thank you very much.
It's a privilege to be here, and I want to thank Dr. Barker for a really, really interesting and dense and rich paper. And what I'm going to do is not so much add to it or comment on it as sort of do an improvisation based on it. Thoughts that came to my mind as I was reading it, as I was thinking about it here, as she was reading it here. First of all, Latter-day Saints are going to be naturally very, very sympathetic to an attempt to view the temple as a model of the universe, sort of scale model representation of reality. That's a theme that would be congenial to us, and I appreciate the temple focus here. And so I'm going to talk about something to do with the temple as I see it, and some themes related to deification from a different angle, or a theosis. The temple is often regarded as a place of ascent. It is the mountain of the Lord's house, right? And in some cases, you actually do climb in certain temples worldwide. You physically climb Latter-day Saint temples, too. It's not just a metaphorical climb, but in most, if not all, there is actually a rising up in the building. The Salt Lake Temple is a classic illustration of that. You have a notion of ever-increasing holiness as you go deeper into the structure. The temple in Jerusalem, for example, was organized that way. This is, I say, sometimes a literal ascent, a physical ascent. It reminds me of a story in the tradition that I spend most of my time with, which is the Islamic tradition, that's very closely related to the temple. And that is the story of the so-called Miraj, or Isra, the night vision, or the ascension of Muhammad. This is a story that doesn't actually show up in the Quran, but there may be some allusions to it. They're very unclear, but it shows up in traditions that date to a very early time in Islam, after the death of Muhammad. Maybe they go back all the way to him. And in that story, Muhammad is taken from some place during his ministry, some physical location. It varies depending on the account. Sometimes it's when he's very young and it's near Mecca. Sometimes it's when he's older and he's in the city of Medina. But he's awakened in the middle of the night by three angels, Gabriel being in the lead, who take him in a miraculous way from wherever he starts off to Jerusalem, specifically to the Temple Mount. And I think that's significant. When he's there on the Temple Mount, he leads the prior prophets in prayer. And then there appears to him a miraj, which can mean ascent, but it can also mean a means of ascent, a ladder or a staircase or something like that. And by this, he climbs up or ascends through the seven heavens into the presence of God, who is always depicted in these stories as being literally enthroned in the highest heaven. Now, that story became very, very significant in Islamic tradition. Subsequent mystics try to replicate it. You get all sorts of variations on it. It's often taken as metaphor that the mystics are trying to ascend into the presence of God through a sort of mental or spiritual process. It's not a literal ascent through physically distinct heavens, but nonetheless, it's an ascent, the itinerary of the mind to God, as St. Bonaventure called it in the West. It also becomes a standard feature in some areas of Islamic philosophy, and Al-Farabi and Al-Kirmani and others roughly in the 10th and 11th centuries, who have a philosophical view of the same thing. But their visions of, in this case, 10 steps up to the presence of God is correlated with their understanding of astronomy. They're passing through the planetary spheres, which is related to older notions that you find worldwide. But going up into the presence of God. In Muhammad's case, Muhammad ascends into the physical presence of God and receives his commission as a prophet, or at least instructions for his behavior as a prophet, or things he's to teach his people. In the mystical experiences, they achieve what sometimes is known as fana', which is disappearance, really, vanishing, becoming one with deity, which in a sense is becoming deified. I was struck by some things that David Larson said about people, these accounts in which people go up into the divine throne room and see themselves or something like themselves seated upon the throne. One of the most famous mystical texts from medieval Islam is a text called the Mantaq al-Tayr, the Conference of the Birds, in which a Persian writer, Farid ad-Din Attar, writes about a group of birds who get together. It's all metaphorical, of course, allegorical. They are they're trying to seek the king of the birds, the monarch of the birds, who's known in Persian legend as the Simurgh. Hundreds of thousands of birds start off, but it's a very difficult path, and they pass through various valleys and ordeals and tests. By the time they get up to the throne room of the Simurgh, there are only 30 of them left who've made it. And then to their astonishment, when they get there, they realize that upon the throne is themselves. And it turns out there's a pun in Persian. Simurgh is not only the name of the mythical bird, it also means in Persian 30 birds. Okay? So there's, again, this sense they recognize themselves. Now, I'm struck, too, by the emphasis that Dr. Barker places on the idea of the temple officiator, the high priest, as a representative, almost the reality of the Lord himself. And I think of our own practice, the Doctrine and Covenants statement that says a person acting in authority or acting in a proper way of that person, whether by mine own voice or by the voice of my servants, it is the same. And you think of cases in which temple officiators actually represent the Lord, the earthly presence of the Lord, in a sense. And even in our ordinary utterances in the church, when we end prayers or performatory ordinances or talks in church, we end sometimes very often perfunctorily and without thought, but we should be giving it serious thought because we end in the name of Jesus Christ, right? As if we were Jesus Christ there speaking, which seems to me to put a real burden on us to try to make sure that what we're saying is at least roughly the kind of thing that ought to be said on that occasion. I like the emphasis on John 17, the oneness there, the high priestly prayer. Let me just say something very briefly about that, because I've still got a few minutes. I do. Okay, I can work this in. That is a powerful, powerful passage. And there's a trend now in certain areas of Christian thought to apply John 17 to the doctrine of the Trinity. Some people are advancing now, not only in Catholic circles and Protestant circles, but in Orthodox circles, a doctrine of the Trinity called social Trinitarianism, which replaces what you might call the older Nicene substance Trinitarianism. And the idea is that there is a perfect oneness between Father, Son, and Holy Ghost that does not make them one substance. That's a kind of middle Platonic or Aristotelian category that's foreign in some ways to the scriptures. But it makes them absolutely one in purpose, in mind, and an old Greek term that's used for it is perichoresis, which means a sort of perfect mutual indwelling, where each one is perfectly aware of what the other is thinking, feeling. There's not a hair's breadth of difference between them. And the idea here is that that kind of social fellowship, that perfect fellowship that exists between the members of the Trinity or the Godhead, is a kind of fellowship into which, to some degree or another, human beings, based on John 17, might have the potential of gaining admission, that if we are to be one as the Father and the Son are one, then it's possible you could be one with them if you learn to align your will so perfectly and to be so thoroughly indwelt by their Spirit, then you could be one with them in that divine fellowship, and that would be a form of deification. Finally, I wanted to allude just briefly to one area where I think the Latter-day Saints take the idea of deification in a very special way, and that is reflected in the New Testament in Paul's address to the Athenians on Mars Hill. He faces a really interesting challenge there because he's not able to cite Scripture. Citing the Bible to a group of pagans on top of Mars Hill by the Acropolis in Athens would have been sort of pointless. They didn't know anything about or care anything about the Bible. And so he appeals to them using a different approach. And one of the passages is of extreme interest to me. This is where in chapter 17 of Acts, verses 28 and 29, he quotes a couple of pagan poets to his audience there. Paul is well educated. He knows the pagan literature as well as the Bible. He says, "For in him," I'm using the King James Version, "for in him," that is speaking of God, "we live and move and have our being. As certain also of your own poets have said, for we are also his offspring." Now, the interesting thing about this passage that he's citing is that it's not a Christian poem or even a Jewish poem. It's a pagan Greek poem by Aratus of Cilicia, who's a 2nd, 3rd century BC poet, who's writing about Zeus. Okay? I mean, Paul is assimilating the god of Christianity to Zeus and saying, "I'm going to quote this passage, and it's true. Just as your poet said, we are God's offspring." Now, the word that's translated as offspring there is quite interesting to me because it's genos in Greek. Genos is related to the Latin word genus. You know what that means, right? But it's also, interestingly enough, related to our word kind, or more obviously, kin, okay? It's saying that we are in some sense akin to God, and that's one of the reasons why he then goes on to say, you shouldn't be There's the timer to remind me my time is up. You shouldn't be worshiping stone or wood or anything that, like that. It's beneath you to do that because you are God's offspring, and stone and wood are lower than you are. So you should worship a God worthy of you, worthy of the description God. And one of the ways he makes that point to them is that you are akin to this God. And that's one of the reasons why it seems to me theosis is something that humans can possibly attain because we're of the right kind. That I didn't go into it, but that's a fundamental idea of Neoplatonic philosophy, which becomes very influential in Islamic thought and across much of the Mediterranean world, that we are emanations from God, and because of that, we are in some sense related to God, and therefore it's possible to, in a sense, the different schemes for doing it vary from Proclus to Plotinus and people like that, but we're able then in some sense to climb back up to God because we're of that nature. We come from God, we return to God if we navigate things successfully in this mortal life and in the other tests we have to undergo. This idea of theosis or human deification, divinization, is an extraordinarily rich one. And I used to think that we stood sort of alone in thinking about it. That was one of the dumbest intellectual errors I've ever made because it's all over the place. In Islam, in Judaism, in Christianity, and well beyond, in pagan thought and around the world. It's a fascinating theme.
It seems to me that Dr. Barker's essay, The Lord is One, extends the discussion about the doctrine of theosis back to its earliest scriptural roots. From a certain perspective then, I think that the title of the essay could very well be changed from The Lord is One to The Lord is Many, for by its very definition, that is the nature of theosis, many gods. And Dr. Barker's paper provides a resource in helping us to trace the Old Testament roots and rituals of the doctrine of theosis. The first thing that strikes one immediately upon reading Dr. Barker's essay is her quotation, beginning quotation from John 17, which I suspect some readers do not automatically associate with the doctrine of theosis or deification. However, there is ample evidence from the history of interpretation to demonstrate that deification of his disciples was exactly what lay behind Jesus' high priestly prayer, that they all may be one, as thou, Father, art in me, and I in thee, and the glory which thou gavest me, I have given them. This is entirely about theosis. And though Jesus Christ is the only natural heir of God the Father, that is to say, the only heir by nature or physical birth, we, through the grace and empowerment extended to us by Jesus Christ, may inherit the glory that Jesus possesses. This idea was very much a part of the theology of the Greek fathers of the Christian church and also the Greek theologians who came after the Greek fathers. In fact, the Greek fathers of the Christian church, 2nd, 3rd, 4th, 5th centuries AD, regarded the entire Johannine corpus or the entire corpus of John's writings as an especially rich witness to the idea of theosis. Theologian Peter of Damascus, who died in the 8th century, gives us a capstone summary by invoking the authority of Jesus Christ found in John chapter 17 and other passages in which he says, quote, we become gods by adoption through grace, unquote. The second thing that struck me, you too, is that Dr. Barker's use of John 17 is taken as a springboard to take us back to the temple, its structure, its rituals, as described in the Old Testament, to provide for us the connection between theosis and temple and the ancient rituals found in the temple. This is something that Latter-day Saints readily resonate with. It is in the temple that gods are established through rituals and covenants. And I think here one cannot help but reflect on another Johannine text, which is also a temple text as well as a text about theosis. And I'm speaking of Revelation chapters 2 and 3, which are not extraneous to Dr. Barker's discussion at all, but in fact, I think supplement something that she has argued persuasively. Consider, for example, the specific language found in chapters 2 and 3 of the book of Revelation. Chapter 2, 7, "To him that overcometh will I, Jesus Christ, give to eat of the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God." And as Dr. Barker has noted, the image of the tree of life is a temple image. Chapter 2, verse 10, "Be thou faithful unto death, and I will give thee a crown of life." Chapter 2, verse 17, "To him that overcometh will I give to eat of the hidden manna, and will give him a white stone, and in the stone a new name written, which no man knoweth, saving he that receiveth it." Chapter 2, verses 26 and 27, "He that overcometh and keepeth my works unto the end, to him will I give power over the nations, and he shall rule them with a rod of iron, as the vessels of a potter shall they be broken to shivers, even as I received this of my Father." Chapter 3, verse 5, "He that overcometh, the same is clothed in white raiment." Chapter 3, verse 12, "He that overcometh will I make a pillar in the temple of my God, and he shall go no more out, and I will write upon him the name of my God and the name of the city of my God, which is the New Jerusalem." And then, of course, Dr. Barker catapults us forward to the discussion in Revelation 22. Finally, Revelation 3:21, "To him that overcometh will I grant to sit with me in my throne, even as I also overcame and am set down with my Father in his throne." So the Johannine corpus is filled literally with the doctrine of theosis, and we're grateful to Dr. Barker for extending that back into the Old Testament. An important part of Dr. Barker's essay, it seems to me, is her tackling of the meaning of Elohim, a Hebrew plural noun, specifically as this Hebrew noun relates to the concept of theosis in early Old Testament texts. She quotes one of the most famous Old Testament texts underpinning the doctrine of theosis, Psalm 82, verses 1 and 6, and she provides a translation from the Hebrew that is more literal and, in my view, much more accurate and helpful than the King James Version. This is her translation of Psalm 82, verses 1 and 6. Quote, "Elohim has taken his place in the council of El. In the midst of Elohim, he gives judgment. You are all Elohim and sons of Elyon, the Most High." Dr. Barker then asks some very poignant questions. Was Elohim a plural of majesty, as is often argued in theological circles, used to indicate a singular reality, or was there a memory of plurality within the divine such that a male and a female were necessary to be the image of God? And who was El Elyon? Was he the father of the divine Elohim or gods? One Latter-day Saint response might well invoke a passage from what we consider to be additional scripture that seems to clarify and provide answers to the questions that Dr. Barker has posed. Yes, the term Elohim does refer to a plurality of gods. And yes, the term Elohim comprehends gods of both genders. And yes, El Elyon, the Most High God, did preside over the other Elohim, or gods, that are referred to in Psalm 82. I quote from the LDS canon, the Book of Abraham, chapter 4, verses 26 and 27. Quote, "And the gods took counsel among themselves and said, let us go down and form man," or Adam, little meaning of the word, "form man in our image after our likeness. So the gods went down to organize man," I suppose bara Adam in the Hebrew. "So the gods went down to organize man in their own image, male and female, to form they them." As Dr. Barker notes, Jesus himself quoted Psalm 82:6 to certain Jews who wanted to stone him for making himself out to be God. As an aside, but I think a relevant one, is that Jesus quotes Psalm 82, verses 1 and 6, while he's walking in the Jerusalem temple precinct. I don't think that that's a coincidence. There is indeed great debate in scholarly circles regarding the meaning of Elohim because the theological ramifications are so huge. But an argument by Professor William Brownlee, one of the early experts on the Dead Sea Scrolls, I think can in fact help us in our quest to define the term Elohim, but by looking at the phrase Yahweh Elohim that is found in the Hebrew Bible and is usually translated in the King James Version as Lord God. Professor Brownlee maintains that the divine name Yahweh is a causative form of the verb to be or to exist, and it literally means then he will cause to be. Thus, Brownlee renders the phrase Yahweh Elohim literally as he creates gods, he creates the members of the divine assembly. This is a stunning, I think, grammatical interpretation, and I think it's true. I'm glad that he agrees with me. Dr. Barker maintains that the Deuteronomistic editors were responsible for significant changes in the biblical texts of the Old Testament. From my perspective, there is no doubt that some plain and precious truths were either suppressed or elided or simply left out by accident, and we have the text that we have today. One of the changes that Dr. Barker discusses was the Deuteronomistic editor's denial of the, quote, ancient belief that the Lord was seen in human form, unquote. She cites evidence from Isaiah, Ezekiel, Daniel, and John. I think additional evidence can be marshaled from the book of Psalms, a major theme of which is that worshipers could come into the presence of God in his tabernacle or his temple, a kind of precursor to the full-blown idea of becoming God or becoming like God. Interestingly enough, elsewhere, Dr. Barker has stated that, quote, the Psalms were the hymns of the temple, and thus we should expect to find some discussion of one of the tabernacles or temple's central purposes, which was to bring worshipers into the presence of God. Elsewhere, Dr. Barker has also argued that Exodus chapter 23, verses 14 to 17, which outlines the three annual pilgrimage festivals in ancient Israel, was later changed. The meaning of Exodus 23, 14 to 17 was changed. Instead of the traditional translation, quote, three times in the year all males shall appear before the Lord, Dr. Barker points us to what was actually the original meaning of the text. Quote, three times in the year every male of yours will see the face of the Lord, unquote. So some of the Psalms which speak of seeking and seeing the face of God in his temple include Psalm 17, Psalm 24, that's 23 in the Septuagint, which is actually more clear than the King James Version, Psalm 27, and Psalm 105. In the last section of her paper, Dr. Barker refers to an early Christian collection of hymns in Syriac, which were used in initiation rites, and this points us to the conclusion that those Christians, quote, were temple mystics and they continued to use the theosis ritual in the temple, that is to say, in the Old Testament temple. This is stunning. I think indeed we now know that not a few early Syriac Christian hymns speak of theosis or deification. From the 4th century Syriac Christian poet Ephraim the Syrian, we find this moving refrain, quote, the Most High knew that Adam wanted to become a god, so he sent his son in order to grant him his desire, unquote. That's from Ephraim the Syriac. From Ephraim's hymn on virginity, we find an allusion to Athanasius' famous epigram, God became man so that man could become God. This is what Ephrem says, quote, "Divinity flew down and descended to raise and draw up humanity. The sun has made beautiful the servant's deformity, and he has become a god just as he desired," unquote. And then finally from Ephrem's hymn in Syriac entitled On Faith, we hear this refrain, "He gave us divinity and we gave him humanity." Well, what does all of this mean to us personally, to me personally? What can it mean? In answer, the following remarkable statement was penned by contemporary Greek Orthodox theologian Christophorus Stavropoulos. Quote, "In the Holy Scriptures, where God himself speaks, we read of a unique call directed to us. God speaks to us human beings clearly and directly, and he says, 'I said ye are gods, sons of the Most High, all of you,' Psalm 82, verse 6. Do we hear that voice? Do we understand the meaning of this calling? Do we accept that we should in fact be on a journey, a road which leads to theosis? As human beings, we each have this one unique calling to achieve theosis. In other words, we are each destined to become a god, to be like God himself, to be united with him. The Apostle Peter described with total clarity the purpose of life. We are to become partakers of the divine nature, 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 4. This is the purpose of your life, that you be a participant, a sharer in the nature of God and in the life of Christ, a communicant of divine energy, to become just like God, a true God," unquote. This, for me, is what Dr. Barker's essay causes me to reflect on. Thank you.
Well, thank you very, very much for these responses, which are, I mean, very responsive to Margaret's paper. Let's finish up by having Margaret make a few comments just generally on the responses and anything that strikes you as particularly gratifying or interesting about what you've heard. And then I've got a few questions.
You've got a few questions, right.
From the audience. So.
Well, my first response always when I hear responses to my papers is, this thing is huge. Whenever you hear responses, whenever I hear responses, they go off in so many different directions. And people pick up things in their own fields of expertise and then they go off and elaborate. And I think what all the responses show to me is that temple studies is a huge and growing network of study, and that it's something we want to encourage everybody to get involved in, because this does seem to be a focus and a framework which biblical studies at the moment, particularly biblical studies, very much needs. There is a lot of kind of fizzy stuff going on in biblical studies at the moment, which ends in fizz, and isn't an awful lot of use to faith communities. And the one thing you can say about temple studies, it's in its infancy and all that, but time and again, it comes right back to how Christian and Jewish communities live. So I'm hugely grateful to respondents because it reinforces my belief that we're into something very big indeed. So I'd like to thank them very much. Now, Jack, you've got some bits, haven't you?
Yeah, just a couple quick ones. We'll start with an easy one. You talk about the anointing perfume, and one person would like to know, do you have any specifics about how an angel of the Lord smells?
Well, I can tell you exactly how this happens. When I do sessions on temple oil, I actually brew some myself. Now, it's forbidden to make it to the exact recipe. So I use three of the four spices, and I use a yogurt maker which keeps them at the right temperature, and I mix it with the finest olive oil and the right spices and shake them up, and I keep them warm for about 3 to 4 weeks. I've got these little jars. And then you get the most wonderful perfume. It's a mixture, really. If you can get sweet myrrh and the ordinary cinnamon that you use in baking and things like that, sweet myrrh is a bit more difficult to get hold of, but the rest from the supermarket. Mix that, sort of shake it occasionally, and olive oil, and keep it warm for about 3 weeks. At the end of that time, you have an unforgettable perfume, but the oil stains. Now, when I go and do these things, I put a couple of drops on a little ball. I call them cotton wool balls. I don't know what you would call them, the sort of things you use for, you know, cleaning up. And in a little polythene bag, and I give them to people to smell. And I say, don't put your nose too near because it leaves an orange stain. Well, you can always see the people who didn't listen because they go around. And you can see them going home with an orange dot on their noses. But the perfume is unforgettable. Now, you can actually try it yourself at home. Olive oil, supermarket cinnamon, and then try and get a little bit of white myrrh. Now, this comes in crystals. Pestle and mortar, ladies, you bash it down until it's powder, about one part cinnamon to two parts myrrh, and leave it somewhere warm, standing on a radiator for about 3 weeks. And then you'll know what angels smell like, and it's lovely.
Well, you've given us the recipe. But what does it smell like?
It smells like a very sweet version of cinnamon. If you can imagine something that's very strongly and sweetly cinnamoned that you're baking in the kitchen, it's that sort of smell, cinnamon and myrrh. And yeah, it's lovely. Once you've smelt it, you never forget it.
Okay, okay, a lot of things.
Yeah.
We learn by our experience.
We learn by experience, yes.
A clarification question. Did I understand that the high priest empties his own blood on the Day of Atonement?
Well, no, that would be a bit extravagant with high priests, but in the old Day of Atonement, the Temple Day of Atonement, it was the blood of the animal that represented the high priest. And any surplus blood that was left after the ritual sprinkling had been done, according to the Mishnah, it was taken and it was tipped out under the great altar in the outer courtyard. There was a kind of grid there, and the blood drained away underneath. And that blood represents life. That's why in the book of Revelation, you have the souls of the martyrs under the altar crying out. And that's because their blood has also been shed as part of the Great Atonement. And that's why in Hebrews chapter 9, the emphasis is that when Jesus died, there was no substitute. He offered his own blood, his actual life, that was poured out. And so the old atonement ritual that needed repeating every year because it was done with substitutes, finally it was done with no substitute, and that was the real thing.
Okay. When did people begin calling John 17 the high priestly prayer? Do you know how far back the connection with that text and the Holy Holies or High Priest might be traced?
Simple answer, I've no idea. Next question.
Something for you to work on.
I can work on it, yes. I can go on my list.
Is there a relationship?
Yeah.
Is there a relationship between the covenant from day one and the covenant of Abraham in Genesis 17?
Well, yes, insofar as all the covenants are part of a great network, but the day one covenant is actually the one you find, it first pops up in Genesis 9, where it's the covenant, the eternal covenant with every living creature. And it's also alluded to in Hosea or Amos, I can't remember, chapter 6, where there is a covenant with Adam, which he broke. And this was a covenant of loving kindness and knowledge of God. And that was the older, all-embracing covenant, of which the covenants with Noah, Abraham, David, it wasn't the covenant with Moses, the covenant that Moses mediated, these are all, if you like, subsets within the greater atonement. So the overarching atonement is the covenant of peace, Berit Shalom, the eternal covenant, the Berit Olam, and we know from the community rule at Qumran that in the time of Jesus, this was called the covenant of loving kindness, which is very interesting. That's why Jesus, when he's talking about his new covenant, this will all men know that you are my disciples because you love one another. You're part of the new covenant.
Back to the old one,
that's right.
Just a comment about the Beatitudes at the beginning of the Sermon on the Mount and what they teach us about theosis.
That's very interesting because Jesus's comment, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God, is, I think, a very political comment about the current state of purity of the high priests in his time, who were a pretty dodgy lot. And to say, blessed are the pure in heart, rather than those who've gone through the right number of foot washings and hand washings and that kind of thing, I think is a very, very important statement. The ones who will see God, the ones who will achieve that blessed state that follows from the vision of God, are those who are pure in heart, not those who've gone through ritual purifications.
Does the concept of most holy people and objects imparting of their holiness have anything to do with the cherubim and the flaming sword in the Garden of Eden?
Well, it must do because it's part of the same temple complex. I would have to think about that one. I think it's a very interesting idea and important thing you've raised. Certainly, being excluded from access to the Tree of Life, that also excluded you from access to the anointing oil, which in tradition is pressed from the Tree of Life. So there would be that link. Certainly, once you are excluded from the Tree of Life, then you are denied access to the source of most holiness and holiness. But that's just off the top of my head. I'd need to think about that. That's quite an important question.
Can you recommend one thing in particular to enrich personal scriptural and scholarly study?
Personal scriptural and scholarly study. Well, you've got to start with prayer. And it's a great help. I think that's all I can say.
The last question is not a question, but a comment. Dr. Barker, thanks for coming.
Oh, how nice.
Thank you all for being here, and keep in touch.
That's right.
And thanks to our respondents. Thanks to everyone who's helped to put this whole program together for all of us. Appreciate you all.